I began conducting the study in January of 2015. That's when I first came here. Lisa told you about all the background that went into this before I came up here. And, you know, I can't emphasize enough how enormous of an effort it was to get all of this off the ground. And, you know, continuing on when I got here, you know, the work that I did in interviewing survivors, that was a huge learning experience. And toward the end of my field work, I came in touch with a woman, a Yupik woman who lives in Anchorage right now, but grew up in the YK Delta area. And she told me a story that I felt, having done all these interviews, was really, really important to communicate in order to really understand sexual violence and violence in general against women in what I consider to be a very unique community. So given the emphasis of storytelling in Alaska Native culture, I found it only fitting that we begin with a story. Some of you might know this one already, so I apologize if this is duplicative, but the story is known as The Woman in the Moon. So the story goes that one evening, a woman was walking on the tundra in a village in the YK Delta in her wedding parka. And all of a sudden, she saw a man in the distance with his dog team. And the man came up to her, and the story says that he began to bother her. Now, whether this means that he was sexually harassing her or maybe doing something a little bit worse, not really known, but that kind of detracts from the story. The point is that she became very afraid, and she began to run away. But as you can see in the photograph or the drawing, instead of running back toward her village, which is way in the background at this point, she ran in the opposite direction. And she ran, and she ran, and she ran some more. And eventually she ran so fast and so far that she began to become airborne. And she continued on and continued on until eventually she landed up on the moon. And the story basically concludes with a very haunting conclusion that she will be up on that moon for eternity, running away from the man and his dog team chasing after her. So I want to begin the presentation now, and I want that story to kind of simmer in your minds and let it marinate a little bit, and we will come back to the story at the end of the presentation, and hopefully we'll do a nice 360-degree resolution and understand what this story means and its implications for violence in this community. So I wanted to start with a little bit of background. Like Lisa said, it's not very common for researchers to go back home to their communities where they conducted their research. So in this case, this background is stuff that I'm sure everybody in the audience knows. But these were some of the observations that I formulated very early on that piqued my interest in this topic. So we know that Alaska has the highest reported rate of rape in the nation. I don't know what the current statistics are, but I believe the current rate of forcible rape in Alaska is 3 times the national average. And this trend began in the early 1990s, and that gap between Alaska and the rest of the United States has just gotten bigger over time. And it could be that that gap has always been there, and it's only been recently, since we've been keeping better statistics, that this problem has become a little bit more illuminated. But we know that this problem has been going on for at least 25 years. And certainly we know that Alaska Native women are disproportionately represented in these statistics in rape, sexual assault, domestic violence. We know that Alaska Native women are very much overrepresented each and every year. Another observation that I made quite early on was one that wasn't so much statistically driven, but it was this more qualitative observation that this experience of rape against Alaska Native women and children almost seems to be an expectation. You know, it's not a question of when it will happen, or if it will happen, but when will it happen. So this guidebook for Native girls, you can see by the title, it is not what to do if you are raped. It says what to do when you are raped. In other words, giving me the sense, okay, this is something that is going to happen, and we need to have a guidebook to tell Native girls what to do when this happens. So nothing really about prevention. It's really, okay, how do we lessen the blow of these experiences? So this was kind of troubling for me to see as an outsider. And after talking with people locally, a lot of people are troubled by this very same issue. We also know that violence against Indigenous women, American Indian women, Alaska Native women, this is not a phenomenon that's unique to this state. All across the country, Indigenous women are disproportionately more likely to be a victim of violence. Native women are 3 times as likely to experience rape compared to any other racial category. Native children are 6 times as likely to experience child sexual abuse. And we know that myriad other social woes, suicide, addiction, gambling, these are very, very pronounced problems in the Native community. And when we've looked at these problems, researchers have traditionally focused on very, what I would call, situational aspects of violence. We're looking at alcohol abuse. We're looking at socioeconomic disadvantage. Are these people living in poverty? What's the educational attainment rate? Are these communities really isolated, geographically isolated? And certainly jurisdictional issues with policing and prosecution and what we can do in Indian country versus the rest of the United States. So these situational characteristics, we've really looked at those a lot, kind of old news. But there is some new news in terms of how we've begun to reorient our thinking on this topic. So instead of focusing on alcoholism, community, structural aspects of the community, some research has begun to position violence against Native women as a function of what's known as culture, conflict, and change. And so this is kind of the road less traveled. This is really looking at the core root of what happens in Alaska Native culture and linking those changes to why violence occurs. So some research has examined the modernization process. Speaking broadly, this refers to things as bringing modern technologies into Native communities. So today we're talking about our smartphones, our tablets, our computers, our cable TV packages, et cetera, et cetera. Urbanization, industrialization, kind of the death of rural economy and the growth of more industrial sectors in rural communities. All of these issues have been linked to turmoil and violence. The adoption of Western economic and political practices, also a very pungent issue that's been linked to violence. In other words, when small-scale societies such as the Bristol Bay villages try to adapt to the modern world by bringing in economic practices and policies and even political frameworks, that process is also said to lead to a great amount of turmoil and violence. And so under this framework, we understand crime, particularly violence, but also addiction, suicide, et cetera, to be really a natural response to these periods of cultural transition, upheaval, and just this sense of normlessness that's generated. So I came into this project wanting to really explore some of these really deep issues and concentrate a little bit less on things like alcoholism, geographic isolation. Not to say that those issues are not important, they certainly are, they certainly came up in every interview I conducted, but I wanted to understand how these things enter into this conversation as well. Now that being said, I still took issue with some of these propositions. So this framework, even though it is a step in the right direction, I still found some problems. First, it's very, very generic. These situations, or these claims, can fit pretty much every situation and not really explain any of them. It also assumes that there's absolutely no difference between native groups and native peoples. So, you know, whatever process you're looking at, this can apply to Native American Indian tribe in Oklahoma or the Yupik of Bristol Bay, Alaska. It really ignores the fact that native groups and native peoples are very distinct and different across all 500 plus tribes in the United States. Most importantly, I found that very important aspects of the Native experience are kind of pushed into the background. So conversations about white supremacy, colonization, historical trauma, these things are pushed into the background and they're not really centered in our conversations. And so when I sat down to really think of what's unique about Alaska, what's unique about the people in Alaska, it kind of drove me to my research question. So my purpose was, you know, it's a very simple question. I wanted to understand the reality of violence against Alaska Native women in a way that centered these important differences. So the assumptions that I came to this community with were that rural communities are different than urban or suburban communities. The state of Alaska is also very different from the lower 48. We'll also talk about those reasons. And certainly Alaska Native culture and its people are very different. So centering these differences was really my core mission with this project in understanding why violence happens to women in this region. And this degree of specificity has been largely absent in discussions on this topic. So the goal of this study was to understand, to gain a deeper understanding about violence against women. And I felt that it behooved me to talk a little bit about how the understanding process actually occurs. The question has been put to me numerous times, you know, how can you possibly understand what's going on? You don't belong to this community. You are not a woman. You haven't gone through this trauma. You're not Native. You are white. Where are you coming from? You couldn't possibly understand. So I sat down, I thought about this, and I felt that it was important to discuss how I approached understanding with this project. This is not an exercise in empathic intelligence, okay? So the ability to put myself in a Native woman's shoes, this was not how I accomplished understanding. Issues of race, culture, gender, etc., complicate this very much. I am not able to change my race. I am not able to change my gender. I'm not able to change my culture. And since I'm not able to change these things and amend these things about myself, I can't put myself in a Native woman's shoes who's experienced this. But what I can do, and what I tried to do throughout the life of this project, was to work on myself. And so to facilitate this understanding, which is a very abstract concept, I went through a process of gradual unlearning before I could reach actual learning. So gradual unlearning, what is this? So for me, gradual unlearning took place when I looked at my own pre-programmed beliefs, beliefs about gender, beliefs about violence, beliefs about culture and community, and breaking those down. So where do these beliefs come from? They come from my own cultural norms, they come from my own upbringing, they come from my own family's values, and certainly my educational background definitely informs these pre-programmed beliefs. So throughout the entire project, and as I was talking to women, and as I transcribed their interviews and listened to them over and over and over again, I was going through this process of systematically interrogating and probing and digging, and finally, breaking down these pre-programmed beliefs and then reshaping them so that I could facilitate this process of understanding what women were telling me. And so the understanding that this that unfolded over the course of, and it's still going on today, to be quite honest, this is conducted by what's known as quasi-ethnography. So Ethnography, as some of you may know, involves a deep immersion into a community for the purpose of gaining a deeper understanding of that community and its people. And to do this, we usually conduct observations, we conduct interviews, and other very qualitative aspects. Our emphasis is not so much on numbers, so generating statistics, making nice charts, and you know, trying to capture thousands and thousands of pieces of data isn't the story, isn't the purpose. The emphasis, instead of on numbers, is on stories. And so what I did for this project was collect stories and interpret stories. This was conducted through a partnership with SAFE. Partnership, I think I'm going to do an edit of this and bold, italicize, and underline that word because that cannot be overemphasized. Lisa spoke a lot about this partnership when she was giving her intro. This could not have happened without SAFE's involvement, or the women's involvement for that matter. SAFE provided operational support, organizational, institutional support, and definitely a level of emotional support to me and to the survivors during the course of this project. So to take this and, you know, replicate it and bring it to scale and do this in other communities, it really requires that institutional backing that SAFE was able to provide. So through this partnership, I conducted life histories with survivors of sexual violence, not just sexual violence, but also DV, stalking, addiction, child sexual abuse, issues ran the gamut. But every single woman I spoke with had some sort of trauma that she was dealing with or had dealt with at some point. Also, key informant interviews were also conducted, a lot with SAFE staff, but also key stakeholders in the community, those working in the mental health profession, those that work with survivors on a day-to-day basis. I also conducted some interviews with them. And then finally, some community observations were done to supplement all of this. And so my methodology really consisted of three steps. The first was getting in, which Lisa spoke about, all the back and forth that happened over the course of a year before I even came up here. And getting in also consisted of establishing contact with survivors and getting them to come in to participate. And then the shutting up and listening part, those were the two steps that were very much a part of that gradual unlearning process that I spoke about earlier. I came to SAFE with a very concrete, defined list of questions that I wanted to ask each and every person. And during my first interview, I had this list in front of me, and you know, I'm taking notes, and I'm trying to, that didn't work. And it didn't work for, it just did not work, because I realized that a cookie cutter approach to this sort of work is not responsive to individual survivors' needs. And so what it really became was a matter of me asking very generic questions. So tell me what's going on in your life right now, or tell me about your life growing up. And then letting the survivors really be in that driver's seat and telling their story their way. Sometimes a survivor would talk about their trauma within the first 2 minutes. Other times it took a couple of hours. As Lisa mentioned, we had to significantly expand the amount of time allotted for each interview. And the interviews ranged from 2 hours and some went to 6 hours. Many women I stayed in touch with after our first encounter, and I talked to a number of them still today. So it's really still this ongoing organic process of, you know, giving a call, talking, getting some updates. So getting in, shutting up, listening, long story short, this was how this was accomplished. The data breakdown, as you can see, I talked with 18 survivors, individual women survivors from 7 communities in the Bristol Bay region. Dillingham was one of those communities, and then I had women from 6 different villages that talked about their experiences. 33 interviews were conducted because, remember, a number of these women I had sustained contact with for the next year and even through today. 82 hours of audio recorded proceedings were the data source that I had to listen to and transcribe. Once I got to the transcribing phase, that resulted in 452 pages of interview text. And finally, the data analysis phase resulted in over 800 individually coded excerpts. And the reason I wanted to give you this breakdown is to really understand two things. First, when we look at the issues that women talked about, so these were all the codes that I had to work with when I was coding interview text, you'll notice that sexual violence up here appears in relatively small text, and there's other words that appear relatively large, meaning the larger they were, the more often they came up. And this shows two things. One, you cannot talk about sexual violence without talking about all these things surrounding it. So women talked about sexual violence in addition to language loss, historical trauma, cultural practices, fishing, extended families, rural life, cost of living, incarceration, gender roles. It is impossible to talk about sexual violence without talking about all these other layers that surround it. And the second reason I wanted to show this was to show just how generous each and every survivor was with their time and, quite frankly, their patience in explaining and unpacking all of this for me, the naive outsider. You know, as an outsider, I did not know a thing about life in rural Alaska, so each woman I talked to was generous enough to tell me, you know, what is a drift permit, what is a native corporation, what is a honey bucket. The patience that was afforded to me was just, you know, I was very impressed with how giving each woman was with the information she provided. So the rest of this presentation, I'm going to focus on the findings of the ethnography. And I'm going to start with talking about some background observations. I'm going to emphasize the native values, traditions, and customs from the women's words, what they believe to be the most important aspects of who they are. I'm then going to talk about some of the economic and political shifts that have occurred in this region over the past 30, 40 years. And this is really the kind of the pinnacle of the presentation, because my hypothesis or my argument is that these political shifts are what we really have to understand in order to understand violence in this community. So I'm going to discuss limited entry fishing as well as the Alaska Native Claims Settlement Act. And once we go through those and what influences those have had on this community, we're then going to dive into the violence that the women talked about, their experiences with violence, the ways that they responded to that violence, and also some of the methods that they used to recover and cope with these traumatic experiences. And as I mentioned earlier, we're going to do a wrap-up and open the floor for some question and answer. And I just wanted to note that there were a number of ways to organize this presentation, but as I talked with Lisa and the rest of SAFE, we decided that the best way to present these findings were to let the women's stories be the primary data source. So for the rest of the presentation, you're going to be seeing quotes from the actual woman, but pseudonyms are going to be used for each and every one of them. So the names that appear on these slides, none of these names are the names of actual people that participated. So quick disclaimer. And with that, we will move on to our first part. It's always an awkward situation when you're presenting to the community where you did your research, because I feel like I'm telling you about yourselves. But this is what I took to be some of the most important aspects of Native culture and Native values. So this is what I saw as kind of the most defining aspects of Nativehood. For one, nativehood was not a singularly defined attribute for any one person. Sometimes, being native, this was positioned as what I call a self-evident category. Alice says, you know, it's what I was born into. It's just who I am. You know, when I go here and there and I have to check a box, I check native, and that's really all it is to me. But for the majority of women, being native was really defined through practices and through values. So, quick rundown, this is probably old news to most people in the room, but respect, cornerstone value, the ability to speak one's language, religious observance and religiosity, spirituality, also very important to nativehood, and of course steaming, using the maké, and subsistence, also very, very defining for what it means to be native. And then a few examples that just really, really stuck out to me. The maké, as many of us know, we understand the maké as having this function of cleansing before the days of modern plumbing. What it's used for, the primary use was as a cleansing physical health benefit. But as Tamara tells us on this slide, in addition to it being cleansing, she also underscores that it has this therapeutic component. You know, when it involves family and other people you're comfortable with, it makes it more enjoyable. And she emphasizes that this is where she garners a lot of support, because when she's in this environment, she's with friends and family. And she also mentioned, not part of this quote, but this is really how she has facilitated her healing and recovering from violence, because she's back getting at her cultural roots and connecting with friends and family in a way that's really responsive to her needs as a Yupik woman. Also, subsistence. This was probably the most defining attribute to nativehood for every woman that participated in this study. Subsistence really appeared as the linchpin through which every other native value was discussed. So when discussing subsistence and what it means to being native, Diane mentions that, you know, it's not just about filling our bellies, but it's about participating, to be together and to live. And this is the process through which respect happens, because you're respecting others through sharing, you're respecting the land and the land giving back. Sandra also positions subsistence as a defining element of her nativehood. That's what Yupik is to me. And finally, Violet underscores the importance of sharing and this communal sense of community, making sure that elders have enough before ourselves, and that subsistence is really a process that facilitates that. So, with those native values and traditions and customs, next I want to talk about some economic and political rifts that have occurred in this community that have really put Native culture, have really turned Native culture upside down in many respects, and had changed the meanings of what it means to be Native and what it means to subsist, etc. So my conclusion, kind of a coming attraction, is that these two acts that have occurred in Alaska, limited entry fishing in 1973 and the Alaska Native Claims Settlement Act in 71, both of these acts induced very profound shifts in Native values. And so in order to understand violence against women, we have to understand more about these shifts that have happened. So, limited entry fishing, this is probably old news to everyone, but I'm going to give a quick refresher. We know that the purpose of limited entry fishing was to fix the panic of what was happening in the fisheries, particularly in the 50s and the 60s. The fear was that the fisheries were being overfished, and the government needed to create a mechanism to restore biological equilibrium to the fisheries. So this led to the creation of a permit system for both state and federal waters where fisheries are located. And so what the impact of this had in the immediate sense was that what used to be a commonly held open access resource, which was the fishery, this commonly held open access resource got parceled into individual property rights, 1,800 property rights to be exact. So post-limited entry, there were 1,800 permits to fish the waters. And who got a permit depended on several criteria. We won't go into too much detail about that, but basically what resulted was there was competition to enter the fishery because there was only 1,800 permits and there will never be any more than that. And what's happened over time, as many of us know, and what the local community has been put on high alarm with, is that there's been a steady decline in local and native participation in the Bristol Bay fishery. As Brenda mentions in her interview, the value of permits, very, very high. There's this economic value put on a permit. It can be sold, it can be transferred. And so what's happened over time is that there's been this massive out-migration of permits. And what this has led to is this redefining of the fisheries. And as Brenda puts it, it is not the Bristol Bay fishery. It is now an outsider's fishery. And a quick look at the numbers, we see just how alarming this trend is. In 1975, 39% of local, 39% of permits were locally owned. Today, as of 2014, that number has reduced to half. Outsider permits on the rise. These numbers come from 2014. And I believe if you look at 2015, it's even more depleted today for local participation. We'll come back to what that specifically means for violence against Alaska Native women. But first I'm going to talk briefly about the Alaska Native Claims Settlement Act, also another crucial piece of legislation that needs to be understood. Again, I'm not going to go into too much detail, but a little refresher. The ANCSA was essentially created to extinguish land claims that the entire state had been embroiled in the early 70s. And it's not really written down so much. I don't think Congress has really owned up to this. But essentially, ANCSA was a mechanism to allow for oil to be piped down from the North Slope down to Valdez. They had to settle these land claims before that pipeline could be built. So this was really driven by the desire to generate profits. And so to extinguish these land claims and settle this issue, millions of acres of land were given to the Alaska Native people and cash payouts. Something else that happened was the establishment of state chartered Native corporations at both the regional and village levels. And these corporations were established to allow Native people the opportunity to walk in both worlds, to retain their sense of Nativehood and their traditions and practices, but also give them a chance to walk in the modern world where they could make money, live in a cash economy, not rely solely upon subsistence, but like I said, still retain those Native values. By and large, what's happened in rural Alaska has been the opposite. The legacies of ANCSA have been very well documented, not just by me, but by other researchers for the past 20 years. What has happened, it has been argued, is that there's been this trend toward corporatization of Native communities. And what this means is that there's an increased reliance on cash economy, less so on subsistence. There's also a great deal of importing outside labor, particularly in management positions. It also means that there's been certainly a great deal of assimilation or adaption to capitalist and corporate ideals. And what I mean by this, and we'll go into more detail with each of these, is that in this community, if you're to ask a survivor what they see as the major changes in this community, they mention five major things. There's an increase in individualism and self-focus, less about us, more about me. They talk about a preoccupation with wealth accumulation, so earning cash, earning that paycheck, interest in materialism and material goods, and not so much on cornerstone native values and practices. They talk about a survival of the fittest mentality. That's not my problem, that's yours, and if you can't deal with it, then whatever. They also talk about strained relationships, very tenuous relationships between people, between families, between villages. This was especially prevalent in the village settings. And finally, they talked about community classism, this sense of inequality that exists for different segments of Dillingham, for women that lived in Dillingham, but also women that lived in the villages. A quick example would be for women that lived over in HUD. They were very much aware that they were at a disadvantage compared to people living in the other areas of Dillingham. So a very clear definition of who the haves and the have-nots are. So as I mentioned, I'll give some quick examples of each of these and then we'll move on. Wealth and material preoccupation came up extensively in these interviews. There was a lot of discussion about how traditional native values and subsistence practices have been really pushed into the background. As Tamara mentions, traditionally being with your entire family, togetherness, picking berries, picking the net, practicing subsistence together, that's not how it is anymore. It's more about assimilation to the corporate form. I need to be in an office 9 to 5, earning that paycheck, and as she says, bringing up the kids because they don't have your dinner cooked. The main issue is that it's all changed, it's all pulled from its original way. Terry mentions the same thing, noticing a deterioration of the generation of today, saying that it's all about how much money we make, what clothes they're wearing, how they're fed, what they're fed, so they don't get teased. And she observes the same thing as Tamara, that all the values she was taught as a child have been lost. This move from collective consciousness to individualism, this was what I was saying earlier about being more self-focused. Violet mentions that when she was a child, there was much more looking out for each other, and she discussed this issue of people becoming more individualized. People are getting their own voices, their own opinions. And for me, as an outsider with a different culture, I thought to myself, how can this be bad? This sounds like a good thing. Well, as Violet says, before, everyone was a community. We all had a voice, we all spoke as one. So I came to understand that this issue of people getting their own voices, their own opinions, in this unique context, has been a detriment in some respects. Ginny mentions the same thing, that the community is completely broken apart. It's more I instead of we. And she said, there's sometimes the community works together, but that's only when there's a search and rescue or there's some major problem. But in general, there's never this collective action or this collaboration. It's the self-focus has taken over. Strained relationships were talked about in every single interview. Most women talked about being embroiled in some long-standing feud with a person, a neighbor, a family member, or someone in another village. Terry mentioned that there's elementary people in the town saying, if you do something to my family, I'll hate you forever, but that mindset is very prevalent. Mm-hmm. Alice talked about fighting between families, especially in her village setting. And finally, Eva makes this, this very haunting observation in her village that despite how physically beautiful this land is, that it's really the ugliest community because of the fighting and the strained relationships that define that community. And finally, the community classism. People definitely identified the bitters, haves and have-nots, as Terry mentions here. Everybody has a certain class. There's definitely cliques. There's favorites and non-favorites, haves and have-nots. Tamara positioned this community classism in the context of drug addiction and alcoholism, mentioning that even when somebody has an addiction, if they are up here, you can't say anything bad about them, but the people that are down here, they can be ostracized, pointed out, laughed at, ridiculed. So understanding the impacts that these economic and political shifts have had in this community, we're at the point now where we can begin to understand violence and really position the experiences and responses of women as a function of these major rifts that have happened. So I'm going to focus on the experiences that women have described. I'm going to talk about their methods of responding, whether or not they reported, some of their strategies for coping. And finally, just to reiterate, I find that what they talk about when they talk about these experiences is that these are really shaped by historical and current day strains in the community. Just gonna take a quick pause. Okay. So the abuse that women talked about during their interviews really ran the gamut. They talked about issues of rape and sexual assault, child sexual abuse, experiencing, witnessing domestic violence among their parents and among their grandparents, and even experiencing workplace sexual harassment. This was also prevalent for a number of women. So the experience of abuse, it's a very broad definition because it really encompassed a continuum of different behaviors and experiences. Most were in varying degrees of alcohol addiction recovery. I would say 90% self-identified as an alcoholic, and they were all in various stages of recovery. Some had been sober only one day, others were sober 25 years and counting. Victimization was also generally chronic throughout the life course. These weren't one-time incidents. They happened time and time again, from childhood to adolescence to adulthood, and some women were still experiencing these traumas on a regular basis when I spoke to them. This violence almost exclusively happened between family members and close acquaintances, and in a rural community, this isn't much of a surprise. We generally don't have a lot of stranger facilitated sexual abuse, period, much less in a rural community in rural Alaska. And a lot of these experiences involved alcohol, either on the victim's part, the perpetrator's part, or both parts. So that's just a quick snapshot of some of the experiences that were talked about. So now we get to the point where we look at how women talk about violence and how they talk about it in terms of some of these economic and political strains that have happened in the community. So first I wanted to provide some examples of how women framed violence against women as a function of limited entry fishing, specifically permit out migration. So a lot of women have noted that there's a lot more strangers coming into the community each and every summer, and that this has really changed over time. Brenda mentions that even before limited entry and even immediately after limited entry, you knew who the people were from the outside that were coming in every year because they came in predictably every single year. Post-limited entry, as more people acquired permits from the outside, Brenda mentions, you do not know who's coming here anymore. It's a different crop of people every single year, and she frames this as a very detrimental aspect of this policy. Charlene puts it a little more to the point, saying that most dangerous time of year, it's It's the summer. That's when everyone comes fishing, lots of weirdos. And finally, Tamara positions this influx of strangers as a period of time when things are, when women become very vulnerable, saying lots of dangerous situations, everyone's looking for a good drink and a good time. So there's definitely a link between this permit out migration, more strangers coming in year after year, and how women make sense of sexual violence. Some women talked about actual experiences that were linked to the sale of permits in their family and what happened after that permit was sold. Nancy was one of these women. In her village during the late 70s and early 80s, she noted that a lot of people began selling their permits. And she noted that this is when people started drinking and gambling and forgetting about their kids. During this time, because the permit was gone and the money had been all spent, which was pretty common, Nancy had to get a job. And she talked about a backlash that occurred against her. She had mentioned that during when she went and got a job, her husband lashed out against her, mostly because his friends said, well, she's making trouble, she's the breadwinner, you should be the breadwinner. So there's a conflict in gender roles in this case. And she says that that's when she started getting beaten all the time, when she got this job, because she had to work because her husband couldn't be the provider anymore. And Vicki also provides an example of when she actually got a permit post-limited entry, which was very uncommon in the 70s. The point system was set up such that many women did not qualify for drift permits. But Vicki did. And what happened in Vicki's case is she earned her permit and she said, I had a boyfriend that put a .44 to my head, made me sign it over to him so he could sell it. So once again, we kind of see how the preoccupation with wealth, cash, and materialism feeds in to some of this violence that's occurred as a result of limited entry fishing. Violence really isn't the only consequence. I also found a lot of discussion about addiction that entered into this equation. Brenda talked about a cousin of hers that had passed away and passed on the permit to his son, and she discussed the trajectory that followed. Had it for a year, sold it, broke within a year, no more permit, no nothing, gone, nothing to show for it. And what's not presented here is a long narrative about how this particular man spiraled into a life of alcohol and drugs, all of which happened after he sold this permit and his livelihood was essentially stripped from him. Ginny talks about the cultural redefining of what it means, of what fishing means, and the cultural premium that's on fishing. She's convinced that today's generation are blinded by material things. So they might fish, but they're doing it for things that they want to buy. Snow machines, this and that. And she's also inclined to think that the extra money goes straight to alcohol and drugs. Her main conclusion being that the fishing resource, this resource that used to be so, so valued, is being exploited and disrespected today. So now I wanted to talk about some examples of how women respond to this violence. You know, do they report? And when they report, what happens? And if they don't report, why do they stay silent? Why do they choose not to report? And I find that the experiences that women have when they do report, as well as the reasons why they do not report, really are rooted in these issues of historical historical trauma, white supremacy, and oppression. And small town social dynamics also inform these decisions very much. So we're going to unpack a little bit of that. First thing I wanted to talk about was some of the family reactions that some women have encountered when they disclosed abuse. Terry mentioned after she was raped by a family member that Christmas dinners, Thanksgiving dinners are all a matter of the past. They're not done anymore. Birthday parties are history. She doesn't get along with her family anymore, and that she's being blamed for it by her own family. Claire mentions a similar phenomenon in her family, that there's no more family barbecues, no more get-togethers, no more hay time together. And she mentions that this is going on for 8 years now. So this isn't a simple, she spilled the beans, you know, they were angry at her for a little while and then it stopped. This has been chronic for over 8 years now. And finally, Tamara, in discussing an incident of child molestation by an older cousin, when they pulled in social workers, she said that side of the family became very cold to her side of the family. And that's something that's never really been resolved either. For women that reported their abuse to law enforcement, unfortunately, there were fairly negative experiences with that. Marcy mentioned that as a child in her village, there really was no resources, no BPSOs, but in any event, it didn't matter because she was convinced that who would they believe? They probably just got into an argument. They would likely take the perpetrator's side over the victim's side. And Violet spoke very negatively of the police in this community, and she's convinced that community classism that we discussed a little earlier really fuels the decision as to what police will actually do about a call for DVSA. She said it depends on who you're related to, what your last name is, what your history is in the community, that it's all a matter of personal opinion. For women that made it to the court phase, the prosecution phase, negative experiences at that phase as well. Claire mentioned that when she was, when her case made it to trial, some evidence was projected onto a screen in the courtroom, and this included pictures of her genital region. And because this is a small town, she observed that this is a small town. I see these people everywhere I walk, and now they give me this look like, you know, I've seen your privates on screen. And she mentions that if I had known this was going to happen, I would have had no part in that. I would never have reported this. So this really gives some compelling evidence that there's really a need to re-engineer the justice system so that we can actually do justice to our sex assault victims. And Eva mentions that in her case, her perpetrator received a very, very small bail amount and no third party. And she mentions the consequence that he did have an opportunity to ruin another woman's life while he was out on that bail. So not surprisingly, because of these types of experiences that women do have, there's really this decision to stay quiet and remain silent about abuse. And I found that when women talked about silence and why they choose not to talk about these issues with, you know, any formal authority, it's really informed by these historical issues of historical trauma, colonization, white supremacy. When talking about police, social workers, the court system, drug and alcohol treatment, mental health counseling, all of these agents of social control were really framed as symbolic of Western culture. You know, these are white symbols. Vicki made this point very clear that when she was a child, she grew up in a traditional Eskimo home. And when social workers used to knock on the door, that was a signal to run and hide under the bed. The white man is here, the Gussocks are here, we can't let them know who we are or what we believe in for fear that they're going to, you know, break our family apart. And Tamara gives a similar prescription that whatever happens in this house stays in this house. This was instilled at a very young age. We don't involve outsiders, Western culture, anything of that sort. I also found that the decision to remain silent was really a function of one's desire to remain secure in one's community, the desire to stay there and be a consistent figure in a community. Vicky mentioned that a friend of hers, whose husband was being accused of child molestation, she couldn't understand why this friend of hers was taking the perpetrator's part, or the supposed perpetrator's part, over the child's story. And then she realized that it really came down to this issue of, well, what's going to happen after this husband is taken away if he's guilty? It comes down to who's going to chop the wood, haul the water, cut the moose, pay the bills, make the money. All of these decisions and all of these choices kind of figure into that calculus as to whether one is going to make a formal report or not. Terry mentioned that cultural pride has very much to do with this. She mentioned that when her father committed an abusive act, there was concern about him getting his pension checks. And so we know that the money issue, living in rural Alaska, money is a very important consideration. And so don't tell, because it will affect us. You know, we have a lot at stake here when it comes to reporting. But despite the pervasiveness of silence and the reasons why women choose to remain silent about these incidents, and I shouldn't say choose to remain, but why they are forced to remain silent much of the time, I found that there was definitely a mission that each woman endorsed for ending this silence. So how do we break this silence? And I found that silence is really not a traditional way of life for the Alaskan Native people. I found in my research that Yupik elders have actually traditionally advised against silence, saying that this really will induce physical illness, stomach aches, headaches, nausea, and some other physical ailments when you keep things inside. And Maddie makes a similar observation, saying, you know, I don't know where this silence came from, because in indigenous culture, you would have had singing, dancing, movement, noise. So this issue of silence, where did it come from in the first place? And I'm hoping that my study begins to answer some of those questions. But despite this, women mentioned that there's definitely benefits to talking about these issues. Terry talked about being probably messed up in one way or another. She continued to ignore it, possibly suicide, possibly seeking vengeance. Vicky made a similar recommendation that, you know, when she works with children, she tells them, are you holding on to something? Don't hold on to it. You need to let it out or you're going to be sick. And really getting back to these traditional values of not being silent. And Eva tells us that breaking silence needs to happen with all parties involved. So we shouldn't just be telling women to tell their stories, but she says we should be teaching men not to rape. So definitely a mission for prevention. And finally, I found that women were not exactly punitive when they talked about what should be done with perpetrators. And this also has a lot to do with why women might be silent about ongoing abuse that's committed against them by partners, by family members. And Maddie reminds us that they are not our enemies, they are our family members. That what they're doing is bad, but we don't hate the person, we hate what they're doing. And she mentions that if the goal is to punish them, people will not come out, because when this happens, the person doing the blaming or doing the punishing gets blamed. Nancy says pretty much the same thing in her monologue, that throwing someone in jail is not going to solve the problem because they're not forced to look at themselves. So really an emphasis on rehabilitation and not so much on punishment. This was a common theme throughout my interviews with many women. Jenny mentioned something similar, saying that every person deserves a person that will care about them, including people that commit this sort of violence. She said that, yes, they should serve some jail time, but not this simple throw them up, you know, put them away, throw away the key. And finally, Tina kind of reflected on her experiences and some of the mistakes she had made in her life. And she was once a prostitute when she had lived in Anchorage. And when she reflected on that experience, she came to the realization that she came back to this community, she was forgiven, people forgave her, and she pondered as to whether sex offender registration, going on this sex offender list and, you know, registering your address with the state, if this is really an effective method to correct this type of behavior. And you'll see people change. I'm sitting here as a changed person. I was a hooker. They're labeling sex offenders instead of trying to help them. So the common theme that really came across in all these interviews was that there's definitely this need to help sex offenders in their recovery process, and that's not something that's been happening. So, going back to the woman in the moon and what this means for sexual violence, the moral of this story that was told to me much later on during my field work, and I think this woman did this intentionally, it's getting to think about it, but the moral of this story was that when you are faced with a problem in your community, the solution to that problem lies in your village. You know, you should go home to find that solution, to seek that solution. And if you do not, you're going to end up like the woman on the moon, experiencing more problems, more issues, and no resolution. When I sat and thought about this and I analyzed the data, I occasionally came back to this story and I wondered, the one thing that wasn't told was why this woman ran away from her village in the first place. So, you know, she ran away, but what was going on in her life that forced her to run in the opposite direction? Why didn't she turn back? And I'm hoping that this study begins to shed some light on why that might have been the case and why women that I talk to might not be turning to their villages or their communities or to their families to help solve their problems. And so my call to action, taking all of these stories into consideration, is that these top-down solutions that we've traditionally relied upon, you know, taking something you know, from the outside at the state level, at the federal level, and trying to bring it down and fit in a very unique community, these top-down solutions, even if they're labeled best practice or industry standards, they don't work. They're not good in and of themselves. And so if we need to recognize that place matters and culture matters. And so instead of focusing our efforts on these top-down solutions, we really need to prioritize some bottom-up insights. And so these bottom-up insights come from talking with the people of the community and collectively working together to solving these problems in a grassroots fashion. And I think these bottom-up insights are what's really the missing piece of the puzzle to encourage and sustain long-term action. So the big thing with research is we're always wondering, well, how can this be used? How is this helpful? Well, that's interesting, but you know, what's next? What do we do with this? How do we use this information? And I'm hoping that we can take this time to talk about this question together. So right now, I will end and take some questions from you. But as I mentioned, I'm hoping eventually we'll begin talking to each other, have a good cross-pollination of ideas. And if you would like a copy of this presentation, feel free to email me. And thank you.